Here now to expand on some of the myeloproliferative neoplasm abstracts being presented at this year's meeting is Dr. Ruben Mesa, who is the director of UT Health San Antonio MD Anderson Cancer Center. Hi, Dr. Mesa. Thank you so much for being here.
Hello. No, excited to be here.
Great. So there are, of course, a ton of abstracts being presented at this year's meeting. So which ones in the MPN space are you particularly excited about?
Well, it's a very exciting time for MPN research. You know, so one, I think there's important information this year in not one but several abstracts, really how we look at the molecular mutations and their relevance in terms of disease biology, progression, and targets for patients with MPNs. So very recently there was a New England Journal of Medicine article that came out of, from Cambridge, and trying to digest all of that. So that's really key. Second, just the sheer volume and activity of the clinical trials being conducted for these patients, particularly in myelofibrosis, where we really have very exciting both single agent and combination studies.
Good, great. So we're also learning about the results of the Myeloproliferative Neoplasms Research Consortium trial of pegylated interferon alpha-2A versus hydroxyurea in high-risk polycythemia vera or high-risk essential thrombocythemia. Could you highlight the importance of this trial?
Sure. Well, for patients with polycythemia vera and essential thrombocythemia, there still remains an open question as to what is the optimal frontline therapy. And there's controversy that still exists in our field. Should that be hydroxyurea, or should that be some form of long-acting interferon? The MPN Research Consortium is a NCI-funded program project grant. This is a cooperative group led by my colleague Ron Hoffman, of which I am a proud member. This was a large phase three. It was an investigator-initiated study, and the first to really look at this in the frontline setting. What my colleague John Mascarenhas presented this meeting is really the kind of accumulation of that data, the summary of that trial. One, both drugs are very active. We were not clearly able to demonstrate that pegylated interferon was superior to hydroxyurea, but nor was it inferior. So I'd say it was non-inferior, which is an important observation in and of itself. It's an important therapy. We present the molecular findings representing activity against the molecular mutations associated with the disease. I present in parallel with that an abstract with a deep dive related to the symptomatic improvements, where we see good symptomatic improvement with both therapies, some differences between them, but good activity in both, some low-grade toxicities that are from a symptom perspective with patients on the pegylated interferon alpha arm. So again, important study, helps to validate interferon as a safe therapy, as effective in decreasing events, at least as beneficial as hydroxyurea, an important weapon that we can use for individuals that are facing that disease.
Very interesting, great.
Yeah.
Now, we're also seeing a 156-week follow-up of the phase three response two trial in polycythemia vera. So what is new to report with this trial?
So for ruxolitinib in polycythemia vera, there have been two key studies. There was response that had required, in addition to failing hydroxyurea and difficult disease, splenomegaly. Now, response two was a trial that was created in part to recognize that not all patients with difficult PV have splenomegaly. So is it as safe and effective for this group, which probably represents a broader swath of patients with PV? What my colleagues were able to demonstrate and present was that indeed it really has performed very well. Durable responses, effective against symptoms, phlebotomy independence, no long-term safety signal. We had presented in parallel the five-year data from response. So what we see is that both response and response to very safe, very effective, and that splenomegaly, if it's there, it will respond, but it really is not necessary to achieve a response.
Okay, all right. So now let's talk more about some of the other JAK1/2 inhibitors. So are there any other kind of new data that we're looking at with ruxolitinib, fedratinib, momelotinib, or pacritinib?
Well, great. Well, the JAK inhibitor space continues to be very active for MPNs. Rux is approved in MF and PV and really has become the standard of care in frontline MF and second line for PV. We really have three with parts of data both being presented at this meeting but also very active at the moment in parallel with ASH. First, I would say, is pacritinib. that is in an active trial trying to find the minimally effective dose in a drug that's already proven its significant activity for splenomegaly and symptoms in patients both with marked thrombocytopenia as well as those without, in patients with myelofibrosis. So that PAC-203 study is almost done with accrual, and we're hopeful that that might become an agent that will be available for patients with difficult MF in the near future. Second, there is fedratinib, recently acquired by Celgene. This is an agent that already had had a successful phase 3 study, Jakarta, versus placebo improving splenomegaly and symptoms. A successful phase 2 study in a second line setting. It was shelved for many years after a clinical hold over a concern of neurologic toxicity. Deep analysis of those patients showed that that risk was very modest and the clinical hold was lifted. There are efforts now underway with Celgene as the holder of that drug to try to find a regulatory path. And there has been a trial that has been announced that will be accruing soon to support a fedratinib registration to, let's say, complement the data that has already been gathered from the past. Third, there is momelotinib, that it had a successful phase 3 study that I presented at ASCO a couple years back that was published at JCO, as well as a second line study. That drug was in Gilead's hand. Now it has been picked up by Sierra Oncology, and there are efforts underway to find potentially a path for a momelotinib as well. So I'm highly hopeful, as I share with patients, that we may have one, if not more than one, additional JAK1 JAK2 inhibitor available in the near future for them.
Great, that's very exciting. Now, what other targets are we looking at besides JAK? How about any others that are of interest, and are there abstracts exploring them at this meeting?
Correct. So there are many that I would highlight. One, there are both ruxolitinib combination studies, ranging from Rux with pegylated interferon, or thalidomide, or decitabine, or azacitidine, all of which were positive, all of which were intriguing and being presented. There's Rux with a PI3 kinase inhibitor. Both there's been ones from TG as well as from Insight, both of which have been active. There are single agent studies both with the anti-fibrosing agent from Prometeor as well as imetelstat from Janssen, both of which are positive, both being reported as single agent. So a lot of things that really are active in this difficult group. Obviously, you know, what is the next step for those? What is sufficiently active to either try to seek an indication or be used off-label? You know, we know hypomethylating agents are available. They're already being used in some amount now. I would say that the data from this meeting will further impact practice whether a additional indication is really achieved or not. Thalidomide falls in that same category. Pegylated interferon can be prescribed off-label. So there's a range of off-label implications as a less common disease, but some of these other investigational agents may well have a path in the near future.
Great. Well, Dr. Mesa, thank you so much for sitting down with us today and talking about all of these data.
Well, great. No, a pleasure being here. Thank you.
Thank you.